Satan needs a token chemical scientist. Landon crossed the bridge where he crossed over, and he did a lot of behavioral science. And I'm going to basically tell you why we need an HIV vaccine. And after hearing the session today, you want to either slip your wrist or you really agree that, you know, we need to take the person out of the intervention. And that's why an HIV vaccine would be so great, because you put it in the arm and it works in the vagina. So that's why we need an HIV vaccine. We know that the concept of treatment as prevention, which has been mooted to control the HIV epidemic, will not solve the problem. I think you've heard about 1990-90. The theory is that if you diagnose 90% of people who are HIV infected, you treat them, get 90% on treatment, and you can suppress, and 90% are suppressed, you can control the HIV epidemic. But this is not true for prevention, because there is a real public health imperative to find an HIV vaccine or a biomedical intervention, because most of the HIV acquisition happens when you're subclinical. And getting to an AIDS-free generation will require a biologically based primary prevention modality, which has prolonged durability, and preferably this is an effective HIV vaccine. And the reason why this is because most of the transmission occurs very early on in when you're infected, before anybody knows that you're HIV infected. So if you have a look at this diagram, this looks at the sexual transmission of HIV and shows the risk of transmission looking at the viral burden in the genitalia. And you can see that in the first 5 months of being infected, almost half the transmission occurs. And so if you don't catch people in acute infection and when they're asymptomatic, you're not going to actually win the war. And unless we find some excellent ways of diagnosing acute infection and getting people who are early on in HIV, who are early on in the HIV infection to be tested, you're going to miss the boat completely. And although we've seen that 1990-90 impacts greatly on AIDS deaths, so this diagram shows the rate of ART coverage and the rate of AIDS death. And you can see that there's a different correlation, that the more ARVs rolled out, the more impact we had on prolonging life. And certainly we've seen this in South Africa, that since 2009, we've seen a 9-year increase in lifespan due to the rollout of ARV programs in South Africa. If you look at how antiretrovirals impact on new infections, you can see that at a global level, and in South Africa, even though you increase the rates of ARV treatment, this has not impacted on HIV incidence. At a global level, you can see it's plateaued, and even in the US, despite increasing ARV rollout, we have a plateau, and in the US, the amount of MSM getting HIV per annum is about 50,000, and this hasn't really decreased year on year. And so, and this is because HIV is transmitted very early on, and the ability to diagnose and treat people before they transmit is a fundamental misconception, and that's why an HIV vaccine is important. So there are two major things that face the scientific questions that face the HIV field today as we sit. And the questions is, can we use a non-neutralizing approach to produce a vaccine? Or if we do need neutralization, can this protect against HIV acquisition? And so what we are looking at in the next couple of years is three novel strategies to look at HIV acquisition through vaccine efficacy studies. And so which one do you think is going to win? Hands up for LVAC. Hands up. Hands up. Hands up. Come on. You don't like the quiet vector. What about the multi-clade potent Ad26 vector? Hands up. You non-believers in vaccines. Is this a non-believer vaccine? None of you believe that any of these are going to work. Where's your faith? Okay. What about both of them? Are they both going to work? I think we need more talks on vaccines. And yet the other race. Okay, so the other race we're involved in is that, can we provide evidence that a neutralizing antibody given as passive infusion will protect against HIV? Can we find a neutralizing antibody infuse it into humans, and will this protect against HIV? What do you think? Yes, you like this one, this race. Okay, so what we see, you know, in natural HIV infection, there is a race that we see, an arms race, in our body when we are HIV infected and we're not on antiretrovirals. We know that the HIV replicates rapidly, and all the time our immune system is trying to make antibodies to catch up, and so there's this race that happens in our body. And some people who don't go on antiretroviral therapy develop a very potent neutralizing antibody. And what's happened in the past is that we've been able to with new modern technology, identify these antibodies and use them and make them and infuse them back into people. And this is what we do when we talk about neutralizing antibodies. And so the first neutralizing antibody to go into human trials is the VRC01, which is an antibody that's directed against the CD4 binding site. And this is the study that's at the moment in clinical trials. And this is also based on an animal study, a non-human primate study, that shows that if you infuse with a VRC01, you can protect against mucosal acquisition in non-human primates. So there is non-human primate evidence that this may protect against HIV acquisition. And so what has happened, there are two trials in action at the moment, one in North and South America amongst MSM, and the other one is in sub-Saharan women in Southern Africa. And this is a study that looks at two doses of the VRC01 versus placebo to try and find what is the least amount of antibody we need to protect against acquisition. The study will be fully enrolled in women at the end of the year. So what will this study tell us? It will tell us whether what we saw in monkeys can provide evidence in humans. And this proof of concept study that is being conducted will tell us what level of antibody we need, and will provide a benchmark to vaccine development, will help us understand whether we can use this strategy to go forward. And so at this moment in time, we have reasoned vaccine design. We're using human clinical trials with intent evaluation of correlates of protection to design and provide emphasis for ongoing and iterative improvements of our vaccine design. We also know that by evaluating this neutralizing antibody in a proof of concept study, it will be critical to help us understand what we need to do to develop neutralization to protect against HIV acquisition. And for the first time in 20 years, the basic science agenda in HIV vaccine development is based on human clinical trials, and this is what we need to do. So we need many battles to win the war, and we need battles around finding new drugs, finding diagnostics, finding HIV prevention modalities, and finding the interventions to produce an HIV cure. And we need to do all of this all at the same time. But I need to say, and we've heard this a bit today, is that the final battle will be the battle against stigma and discrimination. And we need this battle because we need to reassert the dignity of those who are living with HIV and those who have died in silence and shame. And only when we can do this do we know that our final battle against HIV has been won. So I want to thank everybody that contributed to the vaccine development program, the HVTN lab, the US military, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Sanofi, Janssen, the HVTN core, the Chavi ID, who've been instrumental in bringing some of the new proteins into clinical development, and obviously the people, the biggest funders of HIV vaccine research, and that's the DAVE vaccine research program. Thank you very much.